One, two, three, four.
Hey friends, and welcome to our second episode of Phuture Doctors, a place where you get to meet talented and diverse graduate students, tour research labs, and also learn about science along the way. My name's Stephanie, and today's topic is mechanochem. Well, what comes to mind when I actually hear this word mechanochem? If you guessed correctly, the term itself is actually a blend between mechanical energy and chemistry. In other words, the mechanical energy of an object, whether it's in the form of potential or kinetic, enables that object to cause or apply force to a second object, causing the second object to be displaced. Such as when a bowling ball strikes the pins, causing them to fly out, or when Miley Cyrus comes in like a wrecking ball, demolishing and displacing the wall. In today's episode, we're actually going to meet a Phuture Dr that adapts mechanochemistry into his research. But before we sit down and talk to him, the second question I have for you is, how is mechanical energy applied in chemistry? So here I have a mortar and pestle. You've probably seen these in your science classes or even in your family's kitchen. In my mortar and pestle, I have ferrocene, which is an iron compound, and silver nitrate, which is a metal salt. Combining these two and grinding these two for several minutes, we observe a color change from orange to like a green-black. So what's actually happening? Ultimately, the pestle is a tool that utilizes mechanical energy, which applies force to the chemicals, but instead of displacement at the large scale, we are causing the bonds of the chemicals to be displaced, initiating a chemical transformation. This is a prime example of mechanochemistry, which is defined as a chemical reaction that is induced by the direct absorption of mechanical energy. Here, the bonds between the chemicals absorb the mechanical energy, which causes them to break down and then react in order to form new products. So here, the silver and the silver nitrate is reduced to elemental silver, and the ferrocene oxidizes to form ferrocenium. As a result, we see a color change. Pretty neat, right? But what happens when grinding by hand is not enough energy in order to initiate a chemical reaction? Today, I met with Phuture Dr. Isaiah Speight, a second-year graduate student at Vanderbilt University, working under the mentorship of Dr. Timothy Hanusa. I sat down with him to learn more about mechanochemistry and how it's used as a technique and tool for research. Hey guys, I'm with Isaiah right now. Isaiah is a second year graduate student in the chemistry department at Vanderbilt University.
Hi, how's it going, everyone?
And so before we talk about the research that he does, can you tell us a little bit about why did he specifically choose Dr. Hanusa's lab?
So his lab gave me a lot of different interesting opportunities to do some really unique chemistry. Mm-hmm. So our group does mechanochemistry, and it's really interesting because you get access to new compounds and exciting compounds that can do different things, and those compounds may not be able to be made by typical solution-based chemistry methods.
So in the beginning of my video, I mentioned, or I briefly described what mechanochemistry was, and I gave you an example by using a mortar and pestle. So what type of instruments do you guys use in your labs?
We use a mixer mill and a planetary mill, mm-hmm. so that way we get really good reproducible data and we can scale our reactions up.
So what's the difference between the two, starting with the mixer mill?
So the mixer mill uses a vibrational motion, mm-hmm. and the jars typically shake back and forth. And what happens is that as the ball bearing makes an impact with the wall and with another ball bearing, if there are more than one in a jar, you get harsher collisions, and the collisions cause the chemistry to occur. Mm-hmm. Versus in the planetary mill, you have more of a shearing motion, and the ball bearings tend to roll around the edges of the walls, and occasionally you get collisions between them as well. But that shearing force is what causes the chemistry to occur. And the jar itself, instead of vibrating back and forth like it does in the mixer mill, moves in a planetary-like motion, hence planetary mill. Mm-hmm. And that rotation is what causes the ball bearings to move, thus giving us the chemistry.
What type of variables can you change in order to like either optimize your conditions whenever you're running a reaction?
So there are a few major components that you can change when it comes to mechanochemistry. You can change the mill type. So like I told you, planetary versus mixer. You can change the frequency that you use the mill at. So for the mixer mill, it's measured in hertz. So 30 hertz is a maximum for the machine that we use. And for the planetary, you can change the rotations per minute, as in the rotations that the jar revolves around the main disc, mm-hmm. and that can go up to 600 rotations per minute. You can also change the amount of ball bearings within the jars. And then lastly, in some more advanced setups, you can actually change the temperature of the mill internally.
In today's episode, like what we have so far, we're just describing the methods of using mechanochemistry. So what do you actually use mechanochemistry for in your day-to-day research?
So we use mechanochemistry in our group to access some interesting compounds, like I said before, but our main focus right now as a group is more so towards catalysis. Mm-hmm. And so some of the compounds that we make have been shown to be catalytically active for different reactions, such as the formation of polymers. And catalysts are really interesting because a lot of the processes that we ignore on a day-to-day basis are catalyzed by catalysts. Mm-hmm. And so it's really important to have new and innovative catalysts on the market so that way these processes become greener in nature, more energy efficient, less toxic, and also can expedite the process of making these materials that we use on a day-to-day basis.
In our next episode, we're gonna go more into details about like what catalysts actually are and like what polymers are. So if you're just hearing these terms for the first time, like don't be alarmed. We'll be visiting Isaiah again in our next episode just to go deep into the science of his research. And so please stay tuned with us, and please thank you, Isaiah, for being with me, meeting with me. And we'll see you guys on the next episode.
See you around.
Bye.